So let's talk about relatives. There are lots of different ways that people can be related. Brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, partners in marriage. But in big modern families, keeping track of who's who can get pretty tricky, wondering whether your first cousin's twice removed, or is that second cousin's once removed? Language also has a lot of different ways for clauses to connect up with each other. So how can we know what contribution each one makes, and how did those meanings get there in the first place? I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is The Ling Space.
Welcome to The Ling Space.
We've talked before about how one of language's defining characteristics is recursion, which is the ability for structures to embed themselves inside other structures of the same type. So, for example, a clause might have a noun phrase in it, but then that noun phrase might have another clause nested inside. One family of embedded clauses is relative clauses, as in the dean that Luke's parents met with. Notice, though, that this kind of clause can't stand on its own. You can't say Luke's parents met with by itself. It just has a big gap at the end of it. We can also freely swap out that complementizer for a relative pronoun like who or what. So like, the dean who Luke's parents met with. And we can even drop it all together and just say the dean Luke's parents met with. So what, if anything, ties these structures together? And how does a clause, which we usually think of as expressing a completed thought, manage to combine with a noun anyway? To begin to get at an answer, we actually need to take a closer look at the semantics of adjectives. If you remember our episode on set theory, it turns out that many of the adjectives in English are intersective. That means that if we think of nouns and adjectives like sets, or collections of all the people and things that they apply to, those sets cross over when the words combine. So, a phrase like custom closet literally picks out anything and everything that's both custom-made and a closet. Since in semantics we tend to think of word meanings as functions, though, we need to be a little more specific about how this works. In a sentence like Claire is a CEO, we would represent the meaning of the noun CEO like this. That lambda symbol at the front means that it's a function which gives the value true if whoever it's applied to actually is a CEO. And since the person named Claire fits that description to a T, a true sentence is just what we get. So if nouns can be seen as functions, how do adjectives come into the mix? Well, one way to do it would be to suppose that they're a more complex kind of function, one which takes a noun as input and tinkers with its meaning a little, producing a modified function of the same type as the original noun. So the meaning of a word like married would look like this, with those two lambdas marking the fact that it's more complicated than the meaning that we saw for CEO, which only combines with one thing. If this is right, the adjective is set up to combine with two things. First, it combines with some noun, and then it produces a function which now represents both the noun and the adjective combined. And this would give the right meaning for a phrase like married CEO. The problem with this idea, though, is that we also find adjectives by themselves, like in Claire is married. If the meaning of married is meant to combine with a common noun like CEO, and not with an individual like Claire, we shouldn't be able to understand this sentence, but obviously we do. So to get around this, what we really need is a new rule. If both nouns and adjectives can act like predicates and combine with subjects like Claire or Gloria, they must represent the same kind of function. So when these words join up with each other, we must have some special way of blending their meanings together into one big happy function. Let's call this new rule predicate modification. So when a word linking individuals to truth values, like married, teams up with another word of the same type, like CEO, instead of applying one function to the other, they merge and give us the set of married CEOs that we've been looking for. And with that idea, we take our first big step towards understanding relative clauses. Going back to the dean that Luke's parents met with, it really feels like the same rule applies. The phrase as a whole seems to pick out the exact individual who's both a dean and who's met Luke's parents. In the language of set theory, the meaning of dean intersects with the set of everyone who Luke's parents met with. And this strongly suggests that the same rule is at work, and that relative clauses have meanings much like adjectives. To complete the picture, then, we just need to figure out how relative clauses come to have this kind of meaning to begin with. And in order to do that, we need to think more carefully about their structure. Take a look at the relative clause at the end of the sentence, Haley met a weatherman who uses lots of hair product. You can see that that who starts off as its subject and then climbs to the top of the tree like it would in a question. Now, in past episodes, we've pointed out that if you try to ask about something inside the relative clause, say, about what the weatherman uses, you get gibberish. What did Haley meet a weatherman who uses barely sounds like English, even though we can easily say, what does the weatherman use? The explanation we gave was that that who at the top of the relative clause blocks any words from getting out. What's interesting is that you get the same effect even without that who. What did Haley meet a weatherman that uses sounds just as awful with a complementizer in place of who. And even if we try for a much smaller relative clause that has neither, like Haley met someone Dylan married, we still can't go on to say, who did Haley meet someone married? In every case, that relative clause is a locked box, trapping all its words inside it. What this seems to suggest is that even if it isn't always pronounced, that relative pronoun is always there in some form or another, blocking the exit. And this is still true if all we see is a complementizer, or even nothing at all. And this means that every relative clause, no matter what shape, has two basic and defining features. A relative pronoun at the very top, silent or otherwise, and the gap that's left behind when it moved there. So to understand how relative clauses come to mean what they mean, we need to understand something we've mostly been taking for granted up until now. We need to work out the semantics of movement. To nail down how words moving around in sentences affects their meaning, it's helpful to consider a more straightforward kind of relative clause, the such-that relative. Take the noun phrase, the parking lot such that Jay owns it. It may sound stilted, but it gives us the last piece we need to understand what's going on. Like the relative clauses we've already seen, this one seems to have an intersective meaning. In this case, we seem to be talking about something that's both a parking lot and that Jay owns. In other words, the clause, such that Jay owns it, acts a lot like an adjective. So, exactly how does this work? Well, by itself, a pronoun like it is usually a variable, like the x's and y's you see in math equations. It doesn't have any real meaning of its own, but in a sentence like Alex wrote it or Manny read it, it can become fixed by the surrounding context. In a relative clause, though, under a word like such, it stays a variable and remains open to combining with whatever noun the clause attaches to. A word like such, then, manages to transform an ordinary sentence into the same kind of function as an adjective. Turning back to ordinary relatives now, we can draw a connection with the parking lot which Jay owns. In place of a pronoun, we now have the gap that's been left by which moving over to the front. And if we go on to treat that gap like a variable, just like we did the pronoun, then we're left to conclude that words like such and which are kind of like that lambda x we always see at the start of all our functions. The whole relative clause, then, comes out to mean lambda x, J owns x, a function which combines with different objects and spits out true as long as J owns them. Movement, then, triggers the process of lambda abstraction. It turns what would otherwise be a standard sentence into the kind of function that either combines with an individual or, under the right circumstances, a whole set of individuals. And so it turns out that a bit of movement goes a long way in mending what could otherwise be a very dysfunctional relationship. So we've reached the end of the ling space for this week. If you managed to figure out your family tree, you learned that relative clauses act a lot like adjectives when it comes to the nouns that they combine with. That they come in a few different shapes, but all involve movement of some phrase over to the front of the clause. And that when words move around, they turn whatever they leave behind into the kind of function that can then combine with the rest of the sentence. The link space is made by all of these amazing people over here. If you want to learn more about other kinds of relative clauses, check back on our website. Oh, and while you're there, why not check out our store? We're also on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal link space, please subscribe. And tap that little notification bell down below if you want to find out right when we post a new video. See you next time. Toridana.